atheists, agnostics, skeptics, free thinkers, whatever you like to call yourself, you are welcome here. At TL Atheist Church, we call ourselves an atheist church because you will never hear anything supernatural talked about from the podium. So today we're having another investigation of the emotions, and without further ado, I'd like to get to it.
All right, let's get started. So I'm going to start this with an experiment. Please trust me on this. Everyone, please go ahead and close your eyes. Just close your eyes. And I want you to envision right now a nice, peaceful forest. Mickey, you're not closing your eyes. I saw that. Nice, peaceful forest. You're walking through the forest. It's calm. There's leaves fluttering in the wind. You're with people you love. You might be eating a little granola snack. I don't know what you're eating while you're walking through the forest. It's very calm. And then you have your eyes open while you're walking through the forest, and all of a sudden there's a bear! There's a bear in front of you! So your heart starts racing, adrenaline, you know, dumps into your bloodstream, all your hairs go erect on your arm, you start trembling in fear, you say to yourself, I'm going to die now. And then you go running away from the bear, you go running away from the hill, and you're down the mountain. Okay, you can open your eyes, by the way. Thank you. So that's scenario number one. So you encounter a bear while walking through the forest, and you have an immediate physical reaction to it. Now, slightly different scenario, let me talk about situation number two. In situation number two, you're going to your college class, you're sitting down, and you're feeling comfortable, and then all of a sudden the professor comes in and says, hey, it's time for the test today. And then you say to yourself, I don't know anything about a test, and your palms start sweating, you start trembling again, your heartbeat goes up, and then, I don't know, you go running screaming from the room, something, but you want to escape the test. So these are two scenarios that describe fear, right? And what I'm going to be talking about today is I'm going to be talking about emotions and what emotions are. And I'm actually going to be focusing on a very particular theory of emotions. This is the theory of emotions developed by William James and Carl Lange. It's called the Somatic Theory of Emotions. And it was also further developed with a contemporary philosopher named Jesse Prinz. And I'll be talking about his contributions to the emotion theory coming up. But it's a comprehensive theory of what emotions are. And I should say something about, you know, why should you care? Why am I talking about this in this context? And the reason that I'm really interested in this subject are, I believe that, you know, understanding emotions is the key to happiness, right? The things that make us happy are things like joy, love, euphoria. Those are emotions. So having a better grasp of how emotions work can help us understand what it means to be a happy person. So that's pretty important. The other thing that's important to me is I believe, with David Hume, that emotions have something deep to do with morality, that our moral emotions are something that drive us to make the right decisions, to do good things. So for those two reasons, I'm super interested in the topic of emotions. And what I'm hoping to do today is describe what I think is a plausible theory of emotions. But I'll talk about some of the issues that it runs into. So let me start with the basic thesis of this theory of emotions. Basic thesis is, there's two claims. Claim number one is that emotions are perceptions of bodily states. That's what this theory says, that emotion is a perception of bodily states. That's the James Carl Lange part of the theory. And then claim number two is that emotions represent core relational themes. So those are the two theses of this, the two claims made by the Somatic Theory of Emotions. So let me start with the first one. Emotions are perceptions of bodily states. Now, according to William James, the natural way to think about that scenario, the first one that I talked about where you encounter a bear in the forest, is the way you describe it to yourself is you have this mental perception that there's a bear in front of you. And then this mental perception causes you to feel the emotion of fear. And then that emotion of fear causes your heart to race and your palms to get sweaty and all the other bodily changes that happen to you. So there's three steps. You see the bear, you have the emotion of fear, and then you have your reaction to that emotion. What William James wants to claim is, no, that's not how it works at all. That's putting the cart in front of the horse. The right way to think about it is, you have a mental perception that there's a bear in front of you, and this perception causes your heart to race and your palms to get sweaty, and that's the emotion. So there's no separate mental state of an emotion. Your feeling of fear is that bodily perception, what's going on in your body. It's the racing heart that you felt, it's the trembling, it's the your hair standing up straight, it's all the stuff that's happening to you. That is fear. There's nothing else to fear. There's not an emotional state called fear. That's something different from your bodily reactions that we just talked about. By somatic state, they mean something very, very wide. So they include, changes in your respiratory system, your circulatory system, digestive system, endocrine system, any change in your body at all, that counts as a change in bodily state. So they want to say all of those, that's what constitutes your feeling, your emotional feeling of fear or anger or sadness. It all has to do with bodily patterns. Those are what those emotions are. And James writes, we feel sorry because we cry, angry because we strike, afraid because we tremble, and not that we cry, strike, or tremble because we are sorry, angry, or fearful. So it's reversed the normal way that people would explain, what those emotions are. And this matches our language about emotions. Notice that this is in some ways very non-intuitive, but also intuitive at the same time. Because, if you're reading, a Stephen King novel, and you want to know whether the character is afraid, you start reading about, his palms got sweaty, you start trembling. And we know that there are typical bodily effects that are associated with different emotions. In fear, there's a rush of blood to your extremities to get you ready to, start running. In anger, there's a rush of blood to your heart to get you ready to start attacking, and then finally, embarrassment, we know the rush of blood to your face to create that red flush when you're embarrassed. So these, according to James and Carl Lange, that's the emotion. Embarrassment is that flushing face, that experience of a heated face. That's your feeling of embarrassment. All right, so how do they support this claim? So you have to understand that William James and Carl Lange were writing at exactly the same time independently. They didn't know about each other's articles, but they ended up using the exact same argument. There's something called, famously, the subtraction argument. And the idea behind the subtraction argument is, if you take all of the elements that people commonly think are part of emotion, if you subtract all those elements out, the one thing that's left is the gut feeling. It's that emotional feeling, and that's what the emotion is. So here's what the subtraction argument is. If I now proceed to urge the vital point of my whole theory, which is this, if we fancy some strong emotion and then try to abstract from our consciousness of it all the feelings of its characteristics, bodily symptoms, we find we have nothing left behind. No, quote, mind stuff out of which the emotion can be constituted, and that a cold and neutral state of intellectual perception is all that remains. So this is actually a pretty striking thesis, because this is very different than what philosophers have claimed in the past in their analysis of emotions. The dominant theories in philosophy have been cognitivist theories, where you believe an emotion is made up of a combination, some sort of combination of a belief and a desire. That's not what's being claimed here. Or behavioral theory like B.F. Skinner, where your fear is all the actions that follow whatever you do. So fear is the running away part when you run into the bear. That's what B.F. Skinner would say. If you're taking the somatic theory, you believe that the essential thing to fear is what's going on in your body. That's what fear is. So he writes, can one fancy the state of rage and picture no ebullition of it in the chest, no flushing of the face, no dilation of the nostrils, no clenching of the teeth, no impulse to vigorous action, but in their stead, limp muscles, calm breathing, and a placid face? The present writer, for one, certainly cannot. So you have to have these physical reactions. All right, so that's one of the two central claims, that emotions are the feelings in your body. That's what emotions are. The second claim is that emotions represent. They have intentionality in the philosopher's sense of intentionality. They're about something in the external world. And what emotions represent is they represent something called core relational themes. So let me explain the second claim in more detail. So we have this theory now that, okay, so emotions are these different feelings in your body, but that doesn't really explain what differentiates something like fear from anger or anger from sadness. All we know is we have these different bodily patterns. So how do we tell the difference between these different things? Well, so the claim, let me say this another way. I always like this example. This is an example from Jacques Poncet, which we talked about a while ago. The example of, so Jacques Poncet, he's a neuroscientist. Who's studied a lot of stuff in rats, right? And one of his examples is there's two things that will cause a rat to become innately afraid. If you want to make a fearful rat, you can take a piece of fabric, and if it has the smell of a cat, it's going to make that rat afraid. Because genetically, you know, a rat's afraid of the smell of a cat. The other instance is you put a rat in a wide open space, it'll be terrified, right? For obvious reasons, you know, swooping birds, owls, bad things. So rat does not want to be in an open space. So if you think about this, though, these are very different scenarios, right? There's not a lot in common between being placed in a large open space and smelling a cat. But they both represent the same thing for a rat, right? And what they want to claim is, well, this is what fear represents for everything. The unifying feature of fear is what fear is about, and that would be, any ideas? Yes, danger. Yes, vulnerability to harm, it's danger. That's what fear is all about. So emotions represent something in the environment. And each emotion has what, I'm going to get into a little bit of terminology here. So forgive me, but I think it'll be useful later on. So Jesse Prinz, he's the contemporary philosopher. He distinguishes between the real content and the nominal content of an emotion. And so in the case of running into the bear, where you have the increased heart rate, that would be the nominal content. So you perceived your increased heart rate, but the real content of that fear is the danger represented by the bear. So you have nominal content, which is your representation in the environment of something, and then the real content is the thing that causes that representation. One more distinction, and he also distinguishes between the particular object and the formal object. So he also wants to say that you're not actually afraid of the bear as a bear, you're afraid of the bear as a dangerous object. So that would be the formal object in this case, and the formal object of fear is always danger. So that's exactly right. The thing that unifies anger or fear is what these emotions are about. And what these emotions are about has nothing to do with what's going on in your body. Your body is just a faithful representation of something that's going on in the environment. And both James and Lange, they both want to argue that this is all can be explained through, you know, Darwin, natural selection, adaption, all that kind of stuff. So Jesse Prinz goes a little farther than that. Jesse Prinz wants to claim that he's trying to tie it in with this work by a psychologist called Richard Lazarus. And Richard Lazarus is interested in this idea of core relational themes. So he wants to tie in the idea that what danger is and what the objects of the different emotions represent are core relational themes that have to do with our goals in the environment. But this is really a way to try to unify together the emotions and say that they all have something in common about how we as organisms are able to navigate through the world. Okay, so that's the theory. Those are the two claims in the theory. One of the immediate objections that people have to this theory, though, is it seems to ignore the fact that many situations that cause emotions are cognitive. If you remember back to the two scenarios I talked about in the beginning, you know, the bear case, okay, sure, I perceive a bear, I get afraid, yeah. But if you go on to the test case, the case where I'm, you know, have the professor come in and give me a test, that takes a lot of cultural knowledge, right? I have to make some judgments about it. I have to actually have fears around, you know, taking tests and what that means for my future. That doesn't seem to be a raw perception in the same way as, I don't know, perceiving a juicy apple is in front of me. I'm not going to perceive automatically that there's this test in front of me that will cause all this fear to well up in me. So what's going on there? So William James responds to this objection. First he discusses it by saying, most occasions of shame and many insults are purely conventional and vary with the social environment. The same is true of many matters of dread and of desire, and of many occasions of melancholy and regret. In these cases, at least, it would seem that the ideas of shame, desire, regret, and so on must first have been attached by education and association to these conventional objects before the bodily changes could possibly be awakened. And if these, in these cases, the bodily changes the ideas, instead of giving rise to them, why not then in all cases? So anyway, he's using this as an argument against his theory, because he says, look, if there are these conventional cases where you have to make some judgment and there's cognitive activity going on to make sense of the emotion, well, you might as well just say that's true for all the different situations, and let's give up on the somatic theory of emotions. So he responds to this argument by saying that once there's a capacity of fear there, it can be triggered by anything. It can be triggered by, you know, innate things like fears of snakes and falling objects and large looming objects and loud sounds, but it can even be triggered by convention. And he says it's no surprise that it can be triggered by the consciousness of other people's attitudes. He writes, the most important part of my environment is my fellow man. So what James is arguing here is he's saying, look, we are, you know, natural creatures. We grew up in a natural environment. And our fears are going to be tied to our perceptions of other people's interaction with us. And this distinction between cultural and non-cultural causes of emotions, he's just sort of throwing to the side. He said, your emotion can be triggered by convention or it can be triggered by innate stuff. And it makes no difference for his theory of emotions. Jesse Prinz develops this idea a little farther. He develops this idea of something called a calibration file. And for him, this is an imaginary structure in the brain. He writes about it like this. Calibration files are data structures in long-term memory. Every calibration file contains a set of representations that each can causally trigger the same or similar pattern bodily responses. The perceptions of the bodily responses caused by representations in a calibration file are emotions. So the idea is that you get this little, you know, this file that lists the different things that can trigger an emotion, and whenever you come into a situation where those emotions can be, it goes ahead and triggers the corresponding emotion. And the things in the calibration files can be judgments. For example, he gives the example of jealousy, right? Jealousy is an emotion. So you can feel jealous if you make a judgment that, hey, your lover's been staying pretty late at work every night. What's going on with that? That could be one thing in your calibration file, but it can also be caused by the smell of unfamiliar perfume on a lover's clothes. So that might also mean that there's something going on that's a pure sensation rather than a judgment. So it can have all sorts of different things in the calibration file. But they're all united by everything in a calibration file because jealousy represents infidelity, right? So infidelity is the real content of the emotion. And these are just different triggers for that emotion. Okay, so that's the theory. That's how it deals with the major objection. I want to spend a little bit of time talking about how the somatic theory of emotions fits in with some of the other emotional theories that we've been talking about. And because there's a lot of them, right? I mean, at this point, everyone complains that there are, you know, there's endless numbers of theories of emotions. Just to try to lay them out on a spectrum, you can start over on talk about fundamentalist emotion theories, and on the right side of the spectrum over here, and on the fundamentalist edge of the spectrum, I would put theories like Darwin's theory or like Paul Ekman's theory, where emotions are just something that everyone's genetically endowed with. They're the same in animals and men. There are these basic emotions that exist across all cultures. They're just innate, and we discover them. Fear, happiness, joy, they just exist as basic biological facts, and they're no different from having arms and toes and eyeballs. They're just a different aspect of who we are. So that's the sort of most fundamentalist vision of what emotions are. And then if you move a little bit to the left, you get into a position more like Jak Pongsep. And Jak believes that there's actually a distinction between basic emotions and more cognitive emotions. And so basic emotions are, he would say that those are innate, but the cognitive emotions are more, the cognitive emotions are more based on culture. Now, if we keep moving through the left from there, we get to the constructionists. And those are people like Lisa Barrett and people like James Russell. And they believe that all emotions are pure cultural constructions. That's all they are. So different cultures have different emotions. And then if you want to get really radical on the left side, you go to the Churchlands, right? You go to Paul and Patricia Churchland that says, all this emotion stuff is just part of a failed theory of folk psychology. We should stop using words like you know, joy and sadness, and they're just all made up words. So we should scrap it all and start from scratch. So there's a huge spectrum of different theories in the emotional landscape. What Jesse Prinz is trying to do with somatic theory is he's trying to stick it into, he calls it a compatibilist position. He wants to stick it right in the middle, take some of the ideas from the constructionist side, take some of the ideas from the basic emotion side, and say, you know, everything I'm doing is compatible with all of them. Okay, so let's start with what Prinz says about emotions and innateness. So remember Darwin, Ekman. So what happened was Darwin did these original studies on emotions by setting off, it was really cool at the time, he wrote off letters to all these people he knew all around the world to report back on what emotions people were expressing. He had surveys sent out, and what he claimed to have discovered was that even in very different cultures, people express their emotions in the same way. And then his work was reproduced later on by Paul Ekman, and they came out with, what they did is, they, for example, they went off to Western Europe, and they went to the Boer people in Papua New Guinea, and they discovered that there was a basic set of emotions, anger, disgust, fear, happiness, sadness, and surprise, that are the same across all cultures. So that's great. That's the foundation for sort of the fundamentalist emotion theory. But what Jesse Prinz wants to argue is he wants to deny that showing an emotion is universal shows that it's innate. What he writes is, the problem is that adaptiveness cannot distinguish between traits that are evolved and traits that are learned. Many learned responses are acquired because of the advantages they confer. We call crop rotation. Cultures may have developed guilt precisely because it facilitates group living by keeping cheaters in line. Now, what he's arguing here is, just because something is universal doesn't necessarily mean it's innate. It might just be a really good idea, right? And people keep inventing it over and over again. And so guilt, hey, let's have some guilt. You know, it helps society along. So you can't infer directly from universality into innateness. The other line of attack that Jesse Prinz takes on sort of the Ekman Darwin theory is he appeals to Ordney and Turner's. They wrote a really interesting paper called What's Basic About Basic Emotions, where they attack the idea of fundamental emotions. What they did is, actually they wrote a series of articles. One of the things they did is they collected up a list of 600 emotion terms, and they spent 2 years working with graduate students and people in the population to rate, you know, how emotional does this term seem to you? And to just try to get a list of what basic emotions are. One of the other things they did is they create lists of basic emotions from various emotion theorists. And not surprisingly, they discovered that just about every list differed of basic emotions, which is a little shocking if you think that these things are innate and universal. Your list of emotions shouldn't be different for everyone. For example, things like dejection, wonder, expectancy, those were on some lists but not others. And they pointed out that, you know, embarrassment doesn't get in any list at all. For some reason, you know, no one counts embarrassment. I like embarrassment. Your face turns red. It seems really innate to me, but that didn't make any of the lists. So these lists seem arbitrary. The other issue that these guys had with these basic emotions, like take Ekman's emotion of anger. So Ekman says there's a characteristic way that people look angry. Your brow goes like this, it furrows up in the middle. Your lips get thin. That's the expression of anger. It's the same in Seattle as it is in Papua New Guinea or Western Europe or wherever. People express anger in the same way. What they want to say is, well, I'm not so sure about that, because there are components that you can break this down into, like the furrowed brow. Well, maybe that doesn't represent anger. Maybe that represents frustration. And maybe the thin lips, that maybe represents determination. So you can break down this macro expression into these other subcomponents, and then talk about how they're reused. So they're questioning, and they point out that frustration is made no one's list of basic emotions. So this is kind of weird. So we're now breaking down basic emotions into emotions that don't even make people's list of emotions. So they conclude, the fact that the most popular candidates for basic emotions, happiness, sadness, anger, and fear, are among the most frequently occurring and frequently referred to in Western culture, raises the possibility that theorists unwittingly attribute special status to them simply because of their frequency-related salience. Whatever basic emotions may be, their identity cannot be determined by a popularity poll. So they want to complain that, you know, that's not a good way of identifying emotions. Prinz agrees with this, but he does agree that there is a basic set of emotions. He creates his own list, but in his list, you know, there are things that you wouldn't necessarily expect. There are things like separation distress, panic, anxiety, and in general, Prinz is against this thing called the translatability thesis, the idea that the emotions in our language will directly map onto the emotions that, you know, through science and reflection and further theory that we'll discover. So in that sense, he's somewhat like the church lens, right? In that he believes that a more mature science might substitute our ways of talking about the world, our psychology, so that we have a more accurate psychology. Okay, so the other argument that Prinz talks about is, so that's the argument against innateness. He also wants to argue against the idea that emotions are purely cultural, right? And that's another dominant approach to emotion. And the people who like to say that emotions are purely cultural, they like to come up with examples like, does everyone know what gezellig means? I didn't know what gezellig means. Gezellig is a Dutch word for feeling cozy around other people. So you're feeling, you can feel gezellig right now.
Yeah. That's in Norwegian, the same thing.
Oh, does it really? Oh, cool. Okay, good. Or the Japanese word ame, which is a feeling of dependency like that between mother and child. Or here's my favorite, acadia. This was apparently super heavily discussed in medieval times. People got acadia all the time, came down with acadia, feeling acadia today. It's a spiritual torpor caused by people becoming weary of their regular duties associated with religious practice. So that would be acadia. It kind of more or less disappeared. The other consideration here is the word emotion wasn't even in the English language until the end of the 16th century. That's why if you read older philosophers, they're all talking about passions, right? Hume never talks about emotions, he only talks about passions. And so the idea of emotions is relatively new. Another example, boredom. Boredom wasn't in it was first used in a book in Charles Dickens' Bleak House in 1852. So you couldn't be bored before 1852. So didn't exist. And then finally, C.S. Lewis, he claims that romantic love was invented in medieval France. So before medieval France, no romantic love at all. So the idea here is these emotions all seem to be heavily cultural, right? Prinz responds to this by saying that differences in vocabulary do not entail social construction. They do not even support their non-translatability thesis. We can certainly describe ame or gezellig in English. They're not ineffable. So the idea here is just because we don't have the words in our culture doesn't mean that we don't feel it. You might feel gezellig at some point today, but you just don't have a word to express it. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So in general, Prinz writes, constructionists tend to blur the boundary between emotions and things that merely accompany emotions. More specifically, constructionists tend to blur the boundary between emotions and their causes and effects. Both causes and effects can be culturally influenced without altering the emotion itself. So he points out that different situations might cause anger in different cultures. For example, I used to live in Indonesia. In Indonesia, you never show the bottom of your feet. That's a good way to make people angry. Never show your bottom of your feet to people if you're in Indonesia. So that's clearly cultural, right? There's a cultural trigger of anger. A lot of you are showing the bottom of your feet right now. I'm not getting that angry. So, and also the effects of emotion. Prinz points out that culture influences the effect of emotions as well. Consider facial expressions. If one works as a flight attendant, smiling may be encouraged, but if one works at a funeral parlor, smiling may be discouraged, right? So there are good situations to do these things. I want to go to the conclusion and sort of the general criticism. As I said at the beginning of this sermon, I like the somatic theory of emotions because for me, it simplifies the universe, right? There's not this mysterious emotional state anymore. Sadness can just be explained by your bodily response to something. I like that. I like to reduce the amount of furniture in the world. It cleans things up. So I like the fact that the somatic theory makes things easier to understand. And it does actually, now when I feel angry or I feel sad, I actually do, you know, pay more attention to what's going on in my body and actually think about, well, those are constituent parts of it. I mean, I feel my heart beating faster and my blood rushing or whatever it is. So there's something that's very intuitive about that. The other part of the theory that I like is this analogy between emotional perception and visual perception. That emotion just is a type of perception, because that seems to fit with language again. If I can actually perceive a situation to be a dangerous situation, and I literally mean that, I can walk into a dark alley and I feel danger, right? I perceive danger there. The one thing that doesn't seem intuitive to me is the insistence that cognition is not important to emotion. I think of situations like, suppose I lose a race, I lose a foot race, I'm trying to lose a race, I might feel two things in that situation. I might feel sad because I lost the race, but I could also feel regret. And for me, the only difference between feeling sad and regret in this situation is, if I feel regret, I've just made the judgment that I should have worked harder, should have not slept in during the weekend, prepared more for the race. And then maybe I could have won the race. So it seems like a lot of emotions actually do have more than just a pure, you know, somatic component. The actual cause of the emotion is important in the way that we individuate them and determine what emotion we're having. So that's where I'm going to end. Let's go ahead and stop here and maybe we can take some time to discuss.